What's cooler than Conan the Barbarian? Nothing. Nothing is cooler than Conan. Or no one is cooler than Conan, I should say. It is some of the greatest stuff ever in comics. That being said, as you get older, as a kid, I was sucked into Conan big time. I grew up in that sweet spot in the 80s where John Buscema was doing Conan and Roy Thomas. And it was just this, it was a really great golden age for great work. And you combine that with the Schwarzenegger movie. I'm in. Done and dusted, right? You got me. I'm hooked for life. I'm in like Flynn, right? So I've been a big Conan fan for a really long time. And I recently picked up the Savage Sword of Conan omnibus, so that's what I'm going to talk about. But first, let's talk about Conan. These characters, though, that become sort of these cultural icons, these IPs, these intellectual properties that they start to make money and then they get passed around. You've got Robert E. Howard's OG Conan stories, but then you've got all these different companies kind of dipping in and trying to make a buck, including Marvel, right? They did some really great Conan stuff, but I mean, at the end of the day, they're making money. And so it's a weird thing. It's like anything. It's like Spider-Man or something like this. There's some really good Spider-Man stories out there. There's a few. There's some good Spider-Man stuff, some really good classic, genuinely good, worthwhile Spider-Man reads for sure. But this idea of just obsessively buying, purchasing a character or loving a character just no matter what, I think is really goofy and childish. I get it from a collecting point of view where you just maybe want to collect this thing that you're really into, but even with Conan, I've dropped off. I've totally dropped off of Conan. I dropped off shortly after Dark Horse picked it up, after Marvel handed it over to them, and there was a few really, really, really good Dark Horse. Well, that should I say that many reallys? There's a few pretty good. There's a few. Okay. There's one really good one. There's one really good one. It's this. This is my favorite thing that Dark Horse put out. That's Conan. It's Born on the Battlefield. Kurt Busiek, he's okay. I think he's in deep trauma right now, suffering from stage 4 TDS. But Kurt Busiek did a good job on this with Greg Ruth, who's one of my favorite artists. He's his storytelling is all right, but his brushwork is just fantastic. So Greg Ruth, Kurt Busiek, Born on the Battlefield. This is a great thing that Dark Horse put out. Pretty much a lot of the other stuff they did, I'm not a big fan of it. I did like, like Frost Giant's Daughter. This is okay. We'll get into it later, but really, it's just okay looking back at it now. And then it just went, I think, off the rails. And it's just, I don't know what this character is. It's like emo Conan. I don't know. It's something, as we all know, if you've been around comics, if you've been interested in any kind of cultural anything, especially like a weirdo subculture thing like comics, you know that like certain types of people have kind of, it seems like, infiltrated and wrecked a lot of stuff. So Dark Horse went really off the rails and kind of botched it. But they started reprinting the original Marvel stuff. And I'll show that in the video coming up. And I found it so frustrating because I really want this stuff. I've got some of the original issues, obviously, from when I was a kid, but I'd love to have them collected. But the thing is that when they reprinted them in these things, which are just what a missed opportunity. Just terrible. I bought a bunch of these things and they're so disappointing. They're almost hard to read. I can't stand the recoloring that they did on them. And you can say that, well, it's older work. You have to God damn it. Contemporize? What's the word? You have to make it more contemporary, right? You've got to, like, you can't have this old style dotty printing and this kind of stuff like they had in the original comics. I completely disagree because I have proof that you can reprint really old stuff beautifully with, say, Prince Valiant by Fantagraphics. And also, check out this size. check that out. This is Prince Valiant from Fantagraphics. This is how you reprint something that you love. If you truly love the material that you're publishing, you do it like this. You don't do it like this. This is, who did this, you know? You do it like this. And so I've been hesitating about picking up the Marvel Conan the Barbarian omnibuses that they've been putting out, because from what I can see, I haven't physically seen them, I've just seen stuff online, but from what I can see, they've got that same redone lens flare, Photoshop gradient. Like, who the hell colored that stuff? It looks bloody awful. And it's freaking Conan, right? So they've recolored them with, just from what I think is terrible. I don't mind those loud, gaudy colors that they used to use back in the day. I don't mind that, because to me, this current iteration of recoloring looks terrible. So yeah, I've put off getting the Conan the Barbarian ones from Marvel, the big omnibuses, just because it's $100 and some, and it's like, really, if I want to look at like shit coloring of Conan, I'll look at this. Some people like it. I think it stinks. I think it just stinks. It's a real bummer. Also, like, reprint the books with the covers. Like, why don't they show the cover art in this? I just want to chuck it across the room. Anyway, so Savage Sword of Conan. Here's the thing. Savage Sword of Conan is black and white. No recoloring. I thought I would give it a go. And here we go. So I picked up Savage Sword of Conan, the Marvel Omnibus. What? How big is this thing? 1,072 pages. It's 2.7 kilograms times 2.2. So yeah, that's like 6 pounds. It's a 6 pound book. It's a beast. And so far so good. I have to admit that I am really quite happy with this. I think it's good. This is one of the best Conan things that I've seen in a really, really, really long time. As I said, the Dark Horse stuff, off the rails, not into it for the most part anyway. And the Conan the Barbarian stuff, bad coloring. Just can't do it. Would love to, but I can't do it. Now, one thing that I immediately get red flags over with these kinds of things is the sheer size of them and the structural integrity. Marvel, DC, all these major publishers, they're half the time, they just print cheap garbage. It's just cheap mass market garbage. And it's like, oh, look, ew, it's a big book. Like, say the, I found this with the Sandman omnibuses. I would see them in bookstores, and every time I saw them, they were falling apart. You've got a $150 book, and the interior text block, like this chunk, this block here, it's called the text block. This thing is falling out. It's come off the spine here. The glue is giving way. And to be honest with this guy, it would survive a couple falls, a couple drops down a flight of stairs, and that'd be about it. So I don't believe that it is going to really, really, really hold up, to be totally honest. And I've heard that with the third volume of these, with the third omnibus of the Savage Swords, that they switch printers and they're falling apart. So I guess still to be determined if I should even get the third one. But yeah, I'm so skeptical. This is my problem with these gigantic books. It's like, oh wow, it's 1,000 pages and it's really heavy. And it opens nice and flat. But the thing is that, just break this up. Make it oversized too. Make it the actual size of the magazines when it first came out. Kind of like the Prince Valiants, you know? Like, again, let's look at the size comparison. Check that out. Like, these are almost too big in a way, a little bit awkward, but you could make the Savage Swords larger, actual magazine size, you know, and shrink this by, like, make them 300 pages instead of 1,000, and just break it up a little bit more, and you would I think you could just put a bit more TLC into it. So that's my beef with these gigantic volumes. I mean, I get it. It's kind of cool. It's like, wow, that's a really big book. Yeah. But, when it's falling apart in 6 months and you've got to be really careful when you're reading it and the text block falls out and it's just awkward and this kind of thing. Also, too, when you have something that's shipping this size, check it out. Check out the dings on there. When you're shipping big, heavy books, it's going to get smashed up in shipping because it's flopping around. If you order from Amazon, you've got like some knuckle dragger who's like throwing it in a box. Oh, okay, here we go. And it's smashing around and dinged up. So you're going to get a banged up book because of the weight. So when you're spending $150 on something, that's a big deal. So I'm not a fan of this size. I think it's too much, too over the top, and just break it up. But I guess they want to get the collectors just to get this big giant thing, and it feels like a big tome, So that's exciting to a lot of people, I guess. So let's talk about the actual interior of the book. So here you have the dust jacket. It's quite nice, quite simple. On the back, you've got the covers of what's inside, and these covers are also reprinted inside, which is quite nice. The Direct Market has one of the original covers. I couldn't find that one. I got this one. I came to this late. This thing came out in 2019, so but it's a nice cover. I dig this one here. It's all right. It does the job. It's fine. End pages, nothing. There we've got some classic John Buscema painting there. Great credit page. Great credits. I love how detailed this is. This is fantastic. This is a 10 out of 10. I love it. I love the level of detail and I love the breakdown. Amazing table of contents. This is great. I love this. This is amazing. What a thorough breakdown. Some good Barry Windsor-Smith stuff there. An awesome introduction by Roy Thomas. Very thorough, good history on the publication details and sort of the strategy involved in releasing the magazine. And there you've got the Savage Tales. It was first Savage Tales and then it became Savage Sword. So in the first Savage Tales book, there was a bunch of other short stories, the Fury of the Femizons. Okay, here you've got the Ice Giant's Daughter story by Barry Windsor-Smith. Very classic. He's an odd artist. It's very hit and miss. You can see some titties there. Little adult. This wouldn't make it into the it wouldn't be approved by the Comics Code back then, which is why it was considered a magazine for mature readers. And in this Strange Tales, yeah, you've got other short stories, which is kind of cool. There's Black Brother here, which this is the first and last time you'll ever see it. It was a attempt at something, but yeah, quickly abandoned, and that's it. But some really nice art. Khazar and Call the Conqueror. And yeah, in the top corner, you can see Savage Tales number one, as long as also with the date of release. I really like that indexing in the top margin there. It's really cool. So here you can see some of the art, some Barry Windsor-Smith. Really nice stuff. I love the black and white. And yeah, let's look at this. Let's look at some yeah, here we go. Look at some of this artistic funk going on here. I mean, I love it, right? But it's yeah. So this is cool too. All the extras are involved too, are in this publication. They've got the letters pages and all this kind of stuff. It's really cool. Essays about the universe. Great stuff. Really great. Let's just kind of zip through here. This is wonderful. This is one of Robert E. Howard's poems called Cimmeria that he wrote, and Barry Windsor-Smith has adapted it here and thrown in some art. He's actually changed some of the wording in the poem, which I find is very odd, but each to their own. And here you have just more kind of background on the Conan universe. They really went deep back into this. There is a real love of this world going on here. Again, beautiful black and white art. And you can tell that this book was produced in black and white because the art was to suit. Now, here we go to the Savage Sword of Conan. This was the first issue as Savage Sword, where it was now going to become exclusively a Conan rag. And this, to me, is when it really starts to kick into gear. Great credits, tons of talent. Tons of people involved in this. Gil Kane, John Buscema, Roy Thomas, Chris Claremont, it's just, Marv Wolfman. It's a who's who of the comic world back in the day. Great story here with John Buscema. And it's really interesting, too, with John Buscema, to see the different people inking his work. And you can still see his personality and his pencils behind it, but it's curious to see how people bring it out. And yeah, look at that. There you go. Check that out. That's where it's at. So much toxic masculinity. Oh no. Beautiful stuff. Look at that line work. And because it didn't have to be left open for color, you had a much more intense black and white inking going on. So you'd have to have a lot of people assisting on this because just the what I call the line mileage involved is so much higher. So you've got a lot of assistants coming on to help kind of pull this through. And here and there you've got artists chipping in to fill it up, you know, contributing like spot art like this, and just to fill up the magazine and get it done. But again, the talent is really interesting, a really, really good mix. This is great. The letters in here, these are hilarious. Half the letters on this page are people criticizing the magazine, saying like, "What the hell? What the hell is up with the half-tone grayscale?" And like all this kind of stuff. It's really interesting to see. Like they didn't shy away from people like bitching about the book. And I love this too. It's like so and so from, you know, Victoria, BC, Canada has written in to say, "What the hell is this? And why did you change this character to this character? And why did you make these decisions?" And then seeing the response of them saying, "Hey, we're trying to make some money here." It's quite interesting. It's really cool to see. They really were. It wasn't about fan service. I mean, they obviously loved the thing, but they were really about like, look, we're trying to run a business here, and we're trying to get this into as many hands as possible. And they did. It was really successful. It was really successful. It went on for a really long time. And just imagine going into a gas station and seeing this on the shelf next to Heavy Metal magazine. I mean, I mean, you can't help but get a little bit nostalgic. Oh my God, look at this art. Look at that. Whew. Beautiful. Oh, John Romita. I mean, it's crazy. It's crazy how much talent. Yeah, I don't know about this one. Again, variety. There's a lot of variety. Some a hit, some a miss. To me, this is a bit of a miss, but it's still interesting seeing different takes, different styles. You know, each to their own. Some people might really love this. For me, it's always been John Buscema. He's always been kind of artistic mentor of mine. I'm not a mentor, but you know, he's just somebody that I've always really admired. He's sort of like a mashup of, if you were to smash together Jack Kirby and Hal Foster, you'd get John Buscema somehow. You've got sort of a machismo. Look at that. Awesome. You've got like a machismo of Jack Kirby with him, but you've also got this sort of elegant thing going on. It's funny looking at this art here. John Buscema hated this inker, not personally probably, but he hated what he was doing with his art. But it's beautiful. I quite like it. I think it's great. So yeah, I get editorially they wanted a certain look. I don't know why they did this red thing here. This what why? I don't get it. It's the only color splash. Maybe originally that was there. I'd like to see the original magazine and see if that was actually there, but it seems odd to me. lot of essays again. Cool spot art. Great variety. Great variety of stuff. Look at those women. Damn. Man. Yep. Swords and Sandals and Babes. Very nice book. Nice thick paper as well. I gotta say, I'm not sure what the weight is exactly. But it's quite nice. It's quite thick. And here you've got some ads. Some of the original spot ads that you would see. Great art, really cool. Got some Barry Windsor Smith stuff. That picture on the top right there is just childhood. That's my childhood in a nutshell. Look at how far apart those legs are. That's so awesome. That's the Jack Kirby thing that I'm talking about, the machismo. Powerful, powerful men with a bit of grace. That's where the Hal Foster comes in. It's great to see this ad copy too. World of Excitement, a world. Marvel Black and White magazines. Nice paintings. Here you have some original art, which is great to see. I love this stuff. Really cool to see the actual, some scans of actual originals. Very, very nice. And it's all very well documented too. The credits and everything, there's so many names and there's so much talent and there's so much kind of people doing bits and pieces here and there, and they do a great job of cataloging it all for you. And it's interesting too because you'd have multiple artists working on the same page even, and sometimes people would fill in and do a panel here and there, and it really was a collaborative effort and a really strange way of working. Check this out. Look at that art, man. I mean, I'm an art junkie. Yeah, and here you got Red Nails. Red Nails, I mean, classic Conan story. That's in this book as well. So you're going to get that. That's one of Robert E. Howard's classic Conan stories. So you're going to get that. Yeah. All in all, a recommend. Strong recommend. It's a little on the pricey side, but where else are you going to get it? This is one of the best Conan reprints of any Conan material that I've seen in a really, really long time. Probably that we're going to see in a very, who knows when, if they're actually ever going to do another round of this stuff. I kind of doubt it. I think this might be it. Got some glue on there. Yeah, again, glue. Not sewn. It's glued. So when I'm talking about the text block falling out, it's because that glue is going to split away from there. It's going to break off and it's going to fall out. And a very expensive book that's cheaply glued together, and it's going to collapse under its own weight eventually. So that's the problem with this stuff. But you know what? In the meantime, you're really going to enjoy some Savage Sword of Conan. So, little on the pricey side, but it's a big recommend.